Crusader and Sevier. That's going to be there filming. I whisper something to the boys. I'm like, thank you.
are good.
Okay, guys?
Yep, all good, thank you. That's fine, we can walk as well.
Sorry, just technical question. So this will just come live?
It will come live, yeah. We're just working on getting it on. It'll come live at the time. We're just going to share it from another page to that page, and it will come live. So, we're working on that now, so it should be in about five. At the designated time, it'll just come on.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay.
Do you think it's a big issue? Or?
No.
You've got 20 minutes.
Just the problem is the funny.
Thank you.
video's working.
Yeah, I don't know. We didn't make it.
All right.
Thank you.
sure what the last tripod made it on your face.
Don't bring it. Thank you. Thank you. Welcome everyone, as we're about to celebrate the life of Rose Agnes Muriel Young. And it's great to see so much colour in the room. I'm pleased that everyone got that memo, and I'm sure that Rose will be delighted that the colour has certainly come out. And you'll notice no tie, because there's absolutely no chance that Rose would have accepted me wearing a tie up here today. My name's Greg O'Connor. I've been a family friend for a long time, many decades, and it indeed is my privilege to be here today to celebrate the life of Rosie. And it will be a celebration, I can promise you that. It's her wish that that happens, and it's certainly also the wish of the family to make sure. And when you hear from some of the family members today, I'm sure that they will epitomise that. We've got a link around the world, which I'm sure Rose will be wrapped with, that anyone who couldn't be here gets the chance to participate today too. So hi to everyone that's part of that. On behalf of Donna, Shane and the entire family, it's quite a big old go, isn't it? I'll get to that more in a moment. Thanks so much for coming along. Rosie put so much life into everyone that she knew and were part of her life, that it's cool that you could come along and celebrate that here today. And once we do finish with the official side of things, there'll be an afternoon tea and an opportunity to reflect a little bit more, as there will be during the service, for anyone who does want to come up and talk about some of the stories that are associated with Rose. I looked up the meaning of Rose, as in these situations you do, and it's pretty obvious why she was named, or how she was named. It's after a flower, and that's appropriate given the colour that she loved. And I can vividly remember so many occasions when I was a teenager and into my 20s of attending the Blankney Street residence and enjoying an ale or two the night before, more than one or two, and Rosie being there in some outfits that often I thought to myself, what are you thinking there? But that was her. She just loved to embrace colour and embrace everyone around her. And as we know, she certainly made you feel special when you were there. Shortly we'll hear from Donna about that. But I want to read these out because I think this is as significant as anything that we'll talk about today. Donna Shane Kiley, apologies if I get any of the pronunciations wrong. Jack Krizan, Taniqua Taylor, Brooklyn Melissa, Rex Rutherford Smith, Shaniqua, Vincent Jasper, it's not a race call by the way, Scarlett, Khalil, Mayhana, Renee, Angus, Manaki, Rihanna, Tukaha, Gussie, Amy, Angie, Jay, Rory, Rye. There's a few stud farms around here that if the progeny of one family had that many, they'd be pretty proud of that, let alone the nieces and nephews, and each and every one of them Rosie had time for and was so very proud of, and we're going to hear from many of them here today. After reading all those out, we're just about out of time. I think we've got to hear from a few people, and we're going to start right with you, Donna. So if you'd like to come forward, and I think the grandkids are going to follow you and do a nice wee piece as well.
Hi everyone, thanks for coming. And I chose to go first because I wanted to get it done in a good way. But anyway, okay, so here's my. So I was only 10. I was an only child for 10 years. They were quite peaceful years until the troublemaker arrived. Family life in the 60s was laid back. At least that's how it felt for me. Mum's cooking a Sunday roast, the radio going, Dad in the garage drinking with his mates. One TV channel, no weekend shopping except for the local dairy. The 2 p.m. Sunday afternoon black and white movie. We had picnics, Mum loved picnics. Rivers, beaches, parks, it didn't matter, she loved to have picnics. Dad, not so much. Mum would take me on outings, sometimes just the two of us would go on picnics. You know, I have a memory of being out at Rakaia, sitting on the stones out there, eating some sandwiches, just her and I, so, yeah. Mum would take me on outings, and there's the dressing up phase, so back to the 60s, you know, your white tights, your pink leather shoes, your coats and dresses, matching. Which is kind of nice when you're getting dressed up, but after a few hours it gets pretty awkward, uncomfortable, hot, your feet get sore, your tights fall down, it's just not nice. Who is that? okay, where am I up to? Rosie was a great mum. She tried to teach me right from wrong. I remember when I was young being reprimanded for saying the word bum. And that was when I was reasonably young, but I couldn't understand why I couldn't say that word. Now we say much worse. Mum wasn't a person to use bad language. In later years, when needed, she used some colourful adjectives, but overall, that just wasn't her style. Mum married young, at least by today's standards. Mum would have liked more children. Sadly, it wasn't meant to be. Mum suffered a few unsuccessful pregnancies between my brother and I. This bore her sadness, and from time to time, she suffered with depression. This would have been tough times for her. Mum had her own fashion style, as we've started to talk about already. She certainly tried to stay current over the years. So I remember from the 60s, gold trouser suits, crochet dresses, a stunning purple sleeveless gown. So she went to some formal occasion where she had this gown. And I've said here that it's a classic 1960s, the purple sleeveless gown was classic 1960s, the classic 1960s bra crops, which is, you know, if you think about, if anyone knows anything about the history of fashion, they're rather pointy in those years. So think about sort of either Anne Margaret from the 60s, or for the younger audience, think Heather Graham from Austin Powers. In later years, her style was heavily pink, purple and sparkles, with multicoloured fingernails and spiky purple hair. You couldn't mistake her, and she wore it well. Her unique style suited her. She made everyone smile with her colourful ways, topping it off with a big, beautiful, warm smile for everyone. I think that's something I remember the most, is no matter who walked into her room, she put on that welcoming smile. It just was on point. My mum was lovely, kind, helpful, encouraging, independent, strong, a giving person. There are many quiet examples of her caring, giving nature, even to the end. Mum put herself in a rest home because she didn't want to burden her family. Mum ensured all her legal stuff was sorted. From time to time, she would let me do things for her. She would use the driving Miss Daisy service rather than let me take her somewhere. Mum learned how to use internet banking and online shopping, ensuring she got her regular wine order in. Mum genuinely cared and took an interest in all the family members, especially the new arrivals, ensuring she had photos of them all in her room. Mum's passing will leave an enormous cavern in all our lives. Not really sure how we will live without you to inspire us. After your long, terrible illness and the rapid recent decline, you are finally at rest and peace. You lived a life of family values, honour and respect. Thank you for all you have taught us. We will do our best to honour you and your life. Thank you, Mum. We love you and we will miss you. Rest in peace. Rest in the peace you deserve and enjoy reuniting with your special loved ones that have gone before. Aroha tono, Mum. Thank you. Okay, so some of the grandchildren of Mum are going to come up and say a few words. Hey guys, know who you are? Taylor, Brooklyn, Brianna and Tukana. Just some facts about Rosie.
Nana Rosie was born at Dandenong Hospital in the Hawke's Bay of New Zealand.
Nana Rosie grew up on a farm.
Nana Rosie went to Matamau Primary School and Dandenong High School. Nana Rosie's first job was at a grocery store in Millwood.
Nana Rosie had one sister and three brothers.
Nana Rosie moved to Christchurch when she was 17 years old.
Excellent, great work, Donna. Well done, and well done to the kids as well. All right, the next stage for us is to park the peepers up over there, and we've got some photographs and video that we might have a look at to one of Rosie's favourite tunes.
Thank you. Be happy, don't worry, be happy now.
Stand out there, weren't they? The magnificent purple wear.
Cigarettes and alcohol.
Cigarettes, alcohol, and family. And they were pretty much in every photo, every element of that. So, yeah, she certainly had some fun, our Rosie, that's for sure. Raven's up next, speaking on behalf of the Severinsons, and good old Gail's going to climb at the back end of that, so Raven.
First, it's a poem that my sister wrote for Auntie Rose, and it's from my sister. Sorry, I'm losing feathers everywhere. And this is a little, probably a little bit more like my sister, having a bit of fun. Auntie Rose, there you go. Okay. So my sister lives in Australia now, so obviously can't make it home if we've got quarantine and stuff like that. So this is from her and from kind of everyone, I really, I guess. It's called My Purple Rose. The child I was, when you crossed my path, revealing a smile, warmth, and loving laugh. The kind words you had and plenty of time, often followed by, would you like a wine? Advice you shared and tales of old, you inspired us all, truth be told. I ponder that your blood's not red. I secretly think it's purple instead. I think it might be purple, actually. It radiates from you from head to toe, defining the elegant lady we know. You had strength, courage, wit, and calm. You never faltered or ever lost your charm. Many parties we had over the years, where a brick on my foot brought me to tears. Apparently that's a story Shane may be able to explain at a later time. As the families grew and the time passed, your purple glow remained steadfast. The generations were always in awe of your next nail colour, that's for sure. We were blessed to have you in our lives, and in our hearts you still survive. Give them hell up there, my purple rose. Your star shines bright with colour that glows. For you, I raise my glass up in cheer, as I'm sure you're doing the same up there. My parting words to you and Auntie Gwen are this. Save me some wine and don't drink all of the piss. So that's a beautiful poem from my sister. Fuck, I'm gonna give this a go. Alrighty, never done this before in my life, but it's Auntie Rose, I'm gonna hold it up there and see what the hell happens. And if it fails, then everyone just sing and smile, okay? Time with my auntie, she always knew every single name of her whānau, and she would proudly chat about what they were up to now, what they were doing. She was proud of me, she spoke with me. She always asked what my boys were up to, what my mum and dad were up to if they hadn't seen them for a little bit. And during my teenage years, she was my rock. She listened to me cry, she listened to me talk, she listened to me talk shit. She listened. She never judged, she always loved. And that was, that's Rosie right till now. I'm not going to say the end because I know up there she'll be on a lot of our shoulders every day, and her love will be with us all of the time. She was my godmother, and that I actually didn't really remember until very recently, and just having that special bond with her and then remembering that she was my godmum meant a lot. But you guys meant the world along with us. So never ever forget that. Every day you guys remember that love and hold it in your hearts. Hold it up because, you know, Nan, I started calling her Nan even though she's Auntie Rose because there's so bloody many of this lot. Everyone just calls her Nan. Yeah, but she was beautiful. Thank you, Dad, for giving me such a wonderful auntie. Well, two of them. Auntie Gwen and her will be together watching us all. And, yeah, you know what? Cheers. Auntie Rose knows I need this.
Thanks, Raywin. That took some doing. Not only was that a first time for you, I've never seen that before. So nice work. She'd be very proud of that too, I'm sure. It's now time, if there's anyone else in the room who'd like to come up and share a Rosie moment. It'd be hard to top that one. But if there is anyone that would like to come up and speak, we've still got some family members that are going to, but if there is anyone here, now's your opportunity if you'd like to do that.
Okay, I'm not going to try and beat that or even get close to it. Somebody said when you're standing at a gathering like this, all pretend that everybody's naked. Don't be afraid, I haven't got that kind of imagination. Anyway, I'm the baby of the family. Rose was the baby of the family till I was until I come along about five and a half years later, and we had some really good times at the farm. And but before I start, I'd actually like to thank the people over here. I'd like to thank Donna and Shane, Renee and Gus, Amy, Jack, and all their close family for what they've done for us over the last few days. Okay, one or two things that spring to mind, little stories that we've had over the years is when we come home from school, sometimes if the dishes were in the sink, we had to wash the dishes. So I had to wash the dishes, Rose dried them. Unfortunately, the tea towel got wet, you see, and bearing in mind I'm nearly six years younger than Rose, for some unknown reason I got the tea towel and flipped her in the legs. And she used to run down the road, so the faster she ran, the more reflective for some reason. we both never forgot that. And when Mum and Dad got home, I'd say, Rose has been mean to me. So she'd get into trouble all the time. Why, I don't know. And also, the neighbours up the road.
She's ringing again.
Also, the neighbours up the road had a farm, and they both used to go and milk the cows. Husband and wife used to go and milk the cows. So sometimes they'd ring Rose up and they'd say, can you come and get our tea ready for us? So when they got home from milking the cows, everything was done. So Rose would go up there and she'd peel the spuds and do the normal things and stuff, put the things in the oven. And this one day she rang up and she said, there's a spider in the sink. She absolutely hated spiders. There's a spider in the sink. Can you come and kill it for me? So I went up there and I killed the spider, all right. Then I tucked it under a lettuce leaf that she had to clean up and left. So I was a real good boy sometimes. But the one story that does come to mind was Dad was teaching her to drive. And in those days, we used to bike to school 3 miles there, 3 miles back, which I had a look on Dr. Google, and it's 4.8 k's if you're in today's standards. But anyway, I was biking home from school this one day, and I thought, what's Dad's car doing parked in the middle of the bridge? So the Matamau railway station, and there was a bridge over the railway line going down to Tihau Road, where we used to live. Funnily enough, on that road was Jack McDonald, or McDonald had a farm. So anyway, Rose was driving across the bridge, which is probably only about 16, I suppose. And Jack McDonald walked on the other end of the bridge with his two dogs. And of course, Rose went to put a foot on the brake, missed the brake, put the foot on the accelerator, and then realised she was going to hit the dog. So she turned the wheel, hit the side of the bridge, and the car, front of the car, went over the bridge and dangled onto the railway lines. So I come along on the bike and I said to Dad, what's going on here? Don't you worry about it. We've got a breakdown truck coming to pull the car back onto the bridge. You go home and don't say a word to your mother, because you know how she worries. Okay, so I biked down the sugar road all the way home and put my bike in the shed and probably threw my school bag on the floor or on a chair or something, I don't know. And Mum said, I'm really worried about your father and Rose. I don't know where they've got to. And I said, oh, the car's hanging off the bridge. So, Mum always had an apron on, nearly all the time had an apron on. And she had, in the apron, she had lollies and matinee cigarettes. So in a hand went in the pocket, pulled out the matinee cigarettes, stuffed a cigarette in the mouth, went and grabbed the wax matches and lit the cigarettes. And every time she got nervous, the cigarette would jump up and down in her mouth, you see. So, anyway, not long after that, the phone rang, and it was one of the neighbours that had seen what had happened, and she rang Mum and she said, oh, Viv and Rose have just been held up a wee bit, but they'll be home shortly. So, yeah, so they did get home fine, but, yeah. But I got into trouble for spilling the beans. Yeah. Anyway, yeah, thanks all for coming, and thanks, Donna, and everybody else. Yep. Thank you.
Maybe. Actually, I'm okay at the moment. Okay, Rosie. You wanted colour, and your people have brought you a rainbow. Wonderful. The colours are beautiful. And over here, got a pink shirt on. Super. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Sandra.
She's another troublemaker.
I am, Rose is my auntie. I'm not allowed to say anything favourite. Anyway, that naked thing is going okay for me, most of you. Some of you, not so good, but most of you is okay. Yeah, I shan't be looking over that way. My dearest Auntie Rose, I could speak for hours of my love and memories of Auntie Rose. Give me a couple of wines and I'll talk of her for days. I have yet to meet another human being as giving, caring, loving, patient as Rose. She was a real life angel. As I said, I could speak for hours. I want to share something that happened the other day. It came totally out of the blue, as if it was meant to be, as if Rose and I made contact. I'm not great with technology, with the phone, with the laptop. Anyway, I had an injury and I had sent some pictures out, and Rose had texted me back saying, as she would, so kind, I hope you feel better soon and it looks awful and all that stuff. And I went to reply and I pushed the video button and I'm going, oh shit, that'll make it stop. And next thing, her face was there, her face in her purple, beautiful, beautiful woman. Ah, Auntie Rose, how are you? I'm like, oh, goodness. we talked about family, how's the kids, how are you getting on? And I don't know. I'm not normally a flowery, gushy person. I'm a red band girl. This is over the top for me, Rose, you know that. This fucking... anyway, I really can't explain it. There was a very special moment where I found myself telling Rose how much I loved her, telling Rose any time I hear the mention of her name or see a picture, a photograph, how it fills my heart with joy and makes me smile. And there it is, there it is. Anyone was to say to me, Rose, Auntie Rose, my mother, my daughter, fills me with joy. And as I smile for you, Auntie Rose, you beautiful human, beautiful human. Yep, so we did that and blah, 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 blah. I'm just reading through my notes, shut up in a moment. Anyway, after I'd said that I love you and you make me smile any time I think of you, her answer predictably was, that's lovely, dear. I always marvelled at the way Rose pronounced her dear. Hello, dear. Goodbye, dear. Beautiful, absolutely beautiful. And that was that. Okay, I need to speak a few words on behalf of some people. My husband Murray can't be here. He sends his sincere condolences to the family and to everybody here today. He needs to stay home and look after the animals. We've got a little bit of a farmy thing going on. So we have pigs. I'm told if you throw a body in with the pigs, there'll be nothing left but teeth. So please, Murray, stay on your feet. No falling over while I'm away. Stay standing, mate. I still need you. I need you. I'd like to mention my children, Connie and David, who can't be here today. They also send their love and condolences. We have recently, well, pretty much soon after Auntie Rose passed, my stepdaughter, stepsister, has passed also. So my last couple of days have been spent at Waikato Hospital, saying goodbye to her. So much aroha to Penny, Connie and David, Penny's family, and my darling husband Murray. Okay. Oh look, there's another page. Oh shit. Oh no. it might be my copy, my first copy. Okay. All right. I have one more thing I need to say on behalf of the Aussie whānau. My beautiful sister Shona and her family can't be here. We all know why, and I shall say fuck COVID, excuse my language, but that's the way it goes. It's all right, Murray, I'll stop swearing now. Anyway, on behalf of my sister Shona, her husband Wayne, Mark and whoever he's hanging with at the moment, Grant and Jess, Nick and Nicole, Andrew and whoever he's hanging with at the moment, and Anna and Jake. Missing you here, I'm wearing this colour for you, Shane, and for Rosie. Represent, so they say. Okay, Shona has given me a verse she would like me to read on the behalf of her family in Australia. Okay, Aunt Rose, I thought I saw her face today in the sparkle of the morning sun. And then I heard the angels say, her work on earth is done. I thought I heard her voice today, then laugh, her quirky laugh. And then I heard the angels say, there's peace for Rose at last. I thought I felt her touch today in the breeze that rustled by. And then I heard the angel say, "The spirit never dies." I thought that she had left me for the stars so far above. And then I heard the angel say, "She left you with her love." I felt that I would miss her and never find my way. And then I heard the angel say, "She is with you every day. Give Mum a hug from us. Rest easy. A tahua wahine." I hope I did you pride there, Shona. I really wanted to say something on your behalf. I don't know. I don't believe people go roses upstairs with Gwen on the piss, drinking bloody wine and smoking up on fags, a storm, and having a good old yak up. So, Mum and Auntie Rose, save a seat for me by the bar, please, and a packet of fags, even though I haven't smoked for 2 years and it's doing me in. No, that's all good. Love to everybody. Love to the whānau. Love to you, Auntie Rose. Everyone that can't be here. Cheers. I can't see.
You can all put your clothes back on now, thank you.
Kia ora koutou, ko Jessica Ingoa. So for a lot of you, you probably won't know me. Some family members might remember me from the wee girl that I used to live at the back flat of Rose's house. So every weekend I would hang out with my nana, and Rose was obviously at the front flat, and I would head on down and go see old Rose, and we'd paint each other's nails and pick flowers, and I just want her to know that I'm really doing well, and I'm at Hagley College now and I'm loving it. I wish her all my love from my mum and my family. My mum and her used to share a smoke from time to time. I do have a little something prepared. I'm going to sing Hallelujah for Rose. Ka koingo ka maharake te mauri o te atua e te kamaka e te kaiwhakaora. Ka hahana te manua i te ehi karangananga kei tō.
Fantastic. How the hell am I bloody going to top that? I promise you, I can't sing, but you can. Nice work. Outstanding. And she would have loved it, for sure. Anyone had a Rosie's roast? Hands up. Because
yeah.
Anyone who's had one would remember that there's none better. You couldn't beat a Rosie roast. They were so bloody good, actually. Shane and I would have a big night out. She'd cook us a breakfast, and I'd end up staying the whole day just so I could have that roast at the end of it. Speaking of Shane, he's next up. I reckon I've been stitched up here. Thank you.
I've got some new glasses, and they're great when I'm reading, but if I try and look at you guys at the same time, then it's going to hurt my head, so I'm going to go on and off. Look, thank you very much for coming. I guess, you know, there's a few things that we've been talking about as a family, and I guess one of them is we're really lucky and appreciative that, you know, we're not in one of these sort of lockdown situations that we've been in New Zealand or that people are in around the world, and, you know, that we got to be with Mum and that you guys, you know, got to, you know, come here today. So, you know, I guess one of the things Mum taught us was, you know, make sure you were grateful for the things you did have. So we're incredibly grateful to be able to sort of be here today. I think the hardest thing for anyone speaking today is trying to put a lifetime into a few minutes. And obviously that's without losing it, trying to keep your composure. I guess what I wanted to do is just share some of the, I guess, hats or some of the different personalities that Mum sort of had in my life. And I guess I'll just run through a few other things. I guess one of the things I remember dearly is Rose the bargain hunter. She loved to go shopping. She never, you know, went to the high-end stores. You know, she'd love to go to the markets or to the $2 shops with family or friends, looking for that little gift for that special occasion or the birthday that was coming up for a friend or for family. And she never paid a big price, and she was pretty good at haggling in her own soft, unique style. And one of the things I really was always amazed with was she could walk away from something if the price wasn't right, or if she felt it was too expensive. Obviously, the $2 shop was a regular place for stickers. She's probably bought the most stickers of anyone in the South Island in the last 30 or 40 years. So Mum loved to shop, and she loved to get a bargain. And you know, sometimes she'd find something special for herself, and normally it would be you know, a bold colour, something to wear or something to take to home. So Mum certainly loved going out and loved shopping. I think the other thing, and Greg sort of just touched on it, is Mum was a really innovative cook or chef, and she loved to try new stuff. And she liked to try sort of new technology. She was a great cook, and you know, whether it was the roast dinner or all sorts of other stuff that she used to be able to do. But I guess some of the stuff I remember, I think it was the 90s, there was the sort of panini trend sort of going on, and she would, you know, there'd be always paninis at home, all sorts of different flavors. But every single panini would be slightly different. 90% of them had some sort of cranberry sauce or cranberry jelly in it. I remember one that was potatoes, you know, so carbs plus carbs. You know, 99% of the time, yeah, it worked, and it worked well. And she always loved to put a fried egg and stuff as well. As time got busy, she found fast ways to do things. She could buy a hot chicken from the supermarket and turn it into a pretty mean chicken curry, you know, in 15 or 20 minutes. You know, and then obviously the microwave, you know, she went through a phase of doing everything in the microwave. And I think we know that things like bacon should not be done in the microwave. But you know, she was, you know, she loved to play around with that sort of stuff. You know, deep fryers, air fryers, you know, all of that, she loved to do that. And, you know, she, I guess her cooking will always be sort of a memory. And I think for a lot of us here, you know, her food was often the centerpiece of you know, a great day or a great weekend. Donna touched on it, but Mum was really a really quick adopter of technology, and I think, you know, at sort of 79, you know, running a smartphone, running a computer, you know, being a massive sort of Facebook user, you know, is high praise. And I think she was that good at it that only in recent weeks has she been showing one of her adult grandchildren how to post some stuff on Facebook. That's pretty amazing. And I guess it's been an awesome way to sort of stay in touch. And you know, for those of you, many of you are friends with Mum. There's a real theme to the stuff that she posts on Facebook. Back in the 80s, when GST was coming to New Zealand, Mum thought, well, I've got to get ahead of this. So she went and did like an office admin course because they needed it for the business. And she really sort of struggled with that. It was my last couple of years of high school and she worked really hard at it. And the teacher said to her, I didn't think you were going to make it, which is a really funny thing to say for someone who got an A+. So she did find it hard, but you know, she worked hard, and that was a massive achievement for Mum. And following that, she often got real compliments from the accountants for Hi-Hi Motors in terms of her bookkeeping and her accuracy, and you know, which is great. But it's even more significant for those of you that know Dad.
Every time you put your glasses on, I drink.
Obviously, one of Mum's big roles was sort of executive vice president of everything sort of social. It's no surprise she liked a drink or a cigarette. But Mum would interact with anybody and socialise with anybody, you know, if they were a genuine, authentic person, and it didn't matter, you know, what the setting was. Gus was just telling us sort of last night that a few years ago, Mum was visiting Rotorua. Gus had his Christmas breakup, and he said to Rosie, do you want to come on the piss with me? So they went to Gus's breakup, and we'll say rough buggers, but that's not the words Gus used last night. And they sat there for 3 hours on the drink, got absolutely pissed, interacted with all of Gus's workmates. Renee came and picked them up, and Gus said they still ask after Mum. Donna, Mavis, or Linda will remember the party days at Blankley Street. All the families in and around there, and the Reeds will remember those better than I will. But it does sound like in the sort of 60s and 70s, Blankley Street was party central, and there was always something going on at one of the houses. I do recall Mum and Dad often going away with Gwen and Keith and having massive sort of weekends away and holidays, and them coming to visit, and it was social. Like every day, you know, 4 o'clock at the latest, the drinks would be out and the smokes would be out, sometimes even earlier. And I think, you know, even in the last few years, you know, Mum and Lou, they had sort of 6 or 7 great years together all over the country, whether it was doing the sort of high wires on the West Coast or going to the Black Bull Hilton. Mum was social, loved to be out and about and having a drink. And I know that everyone here has got dozens of stories of having a joke with Mum and having a drink with Mum. And I guess for a lot of you ladies, having those special Rosie sleepovers where you only needed sort of 4 things, your pyjamas, bottles of wine and a cigarette, and sometimes a slither of food was sort of all it took. And I guess I remember one day, and it was the best part of 30 years ago, it was family day, we went to the Ashburton races, which Mum normally liked, not always, but normally liked. and we're driving down to Ashburton, and the horse float in front of us, the numbers on the back of it were 369, and Mum said that sounds like a box trifecta to me. So by the time race 9 came around and she'd done 6 times 9, $54, she got the pip, gave me and Dad $6 and said, I'll see you in the car. Well, sure enough, 369 rolls in, we go back to the car and we give her a $300 profit she's made for the day. So that was a nice way to finish the day. So it was straight back to High Street to the Dragon for dinner. So that was pretty cool. And I think the other thing that, you know, with Mum is I talked about how she has little bits of food, and a lot of you guys will know that, but you know, she'd often meet you know, the grandkids and Kylie down at McDonald's, eat a full Big Mac, and watch the kids play on the playground. And her last trip to Auckland, which was only sort of Christmas before last, was she had a favourite steak restaurant, and she had a full steak meal. So when she wanted to, she could still put it away. So, but I think we all know that the role that she loved the most was that of being a mum, a nana. And I guess, yeah, to Greg's point, how the hell the two of us ended up with 25 plus, I'm not quite sure, and it's going to continue to multiply. Donna got off to a quick start, obviously, took a bit of time. But I guess what I found this morning is, in terms of your mum's role, she actually left a message for you guys in the book I've been telling you about. So this is from Nana Rosie, guys. Try not to rush through life, it goes by so quickly. Enjoy the good times and cope with the bad ones as best you can. Life does hit its rough patches. Rosie. That might be the understatement of the day. So I guess in finishing, I guess about 4 years ago I was in a shop and I got a book that said Mum's Story, and I gave it to Mum and she's been filling it out, and she always said, oh, I'm not getting much in it. But we found it on Saturday, the day after she passed, and she's done an amazing job with it. And so I think from that book and from my life, this is my interpretation. If Rosie was to give us, I want to say 5 golden rules, but maybe 5 rainbow rules. Well, Mum's not even a rules person, maybe 5 rainbow frameworks. Anyway, so here's my interpretation of what Mum would say in terms of 5 rules for living life. The first one I love, everything in moderation, including moderation. Always look for the positive, even when it rains. For the young ones, rain means when shit happens. Laugh every day, even if it's at yourself. Family and good friends are invaluable. Enjoy the present. And if it is to be, it is up to me. Do your best. Thank you.
Nice work, Shane. I know you weren't really looking forward to that, but you nailed it, so great stuff. Renee is next, and I think we're going to hear a song by Te Kaha off the back of that, too.
Hi,
For those that don't know me, my name's Renee, and I'm Rose's granddaughter. You might remember me from such funerals as Brian Cornelius. Nan's wish was for an upbeat celebration of her life, which is a big task to ask for, not because we're short on great stories, as you've probably heard by now, but because the amazing person Nan is, she's leaving the same size gap in our hearts and in our lives. But nonetheless, how can we repay years and years of unconditional love and acceptance, patience, and most importantly, birthday cards covered in stickers? We can put that effort into a send-off worthy of you, and I hope we get that right. I can humbly say that out of me and my two sisters, I'm the favourite one. I'm the smartest one, or at least the smart ass one. I'm also the best looking. You could say I was blessed with all things great, but as Nan would recall, this didn't start out this way. The day that I was born, my dad was away in the army. So when my mum went into labour with me, Nan was there with my mum. After giving birth to me, the doctor handed me to my Nan. She took me in her arms, like you do when you're in the presence of a legend. She took one look at me, and I wish this part was the joke, but it's not. Oh my poor dear, I'll love you anyway. I would like to state now, Nan does say that I grew out of that. Growing up with Rose as our Nan was so much fun. Nothing more than having champagne birthday breakfast before getting sent off to high school. Just without the champagne and add the $5 bottle of Bernardino. It was my birthday. My sisters and I were having a wine and pancakes for breakfast at Nan's. I was about 16, 17. My little sister was about 13, 14. And it was time to leave and catch the bus to school. And Nan was like, "You haven't finished your wine." She tips it into a water bottle and sends us off to the bus drinking our drink bottles. So now we're at school. I go my way, my little sister goes her way, off to our classes, lunchtime rolls around, and my sister can't be found anywhere. Someone comes to me and says, "She was drunk, she got picked up by mum." I said, "Oh shit." I'm thinking all the way home, get there, mum's like to Nan, "Did you give Amy wine in a drink bottle before school?" Nan innocently, "Yes." Mum goes, "Why?" Nan completely unaware of any wrongdoing and looking at mum like, "Duh," because she hadn't finished it for breakfast. At the end of the day, the reality is still the same, Nan. You're leaving behind an immeasurable gap in all our lives. I will find peace in the fact you don't have to fight for your breath every day. I hope you have happiness that you can finally have a fag whenever you like. And just like I will find happiness in my new air fryer you bought me last week. I love you, Nan. I will miss you immensely, and I think of you often. I've got a song here from my son. He's too shy to jump up in front of you lots, especially following that last song, jeez.
Mother, love is to all people.
Nan, see you later, alligator.
Thanks, Renee. You really got some talent. I think you should just wait, not waste it, on doing it at funerals. Yeah, you should really explore that. Jack and Gus. Jack, in an outstanding ensemble today of pink, yellow, blue. Looking forward to this. I better move this up, though, please. Quite a bit bigger than me. Good luck.
Tēnā koutou. Tēnā koutou. Tēnā koutou katoa. I ngā mihi. I ngā mihi mātou kuia. Tūturu whakamaua kia teina. Haumwe hui e tāiki e. I welcome all you guys today and thank all those who travelled from far and wide. To those that couldn't make it, you're here in spirit. As we gather here today to not mourn, but to celebrate the colourful, wonderful, extraordinary life of Rose Agnes Muriel Young. So I stand in front of you with my vibrant attire, my tissues up my sleeve, and my fluorescent scarf around my neck, proud to call myself a grandson of Rose. Where do I begin? Well, just like Bryan Adams, it started in the summer of 69. Well, for me, it was probably more like 09, where Rose had the privilege and honour to look after two charming, well-behaved boys, so we thought, who go by the names in this context of Vincent the Great and Jack the Conqueror. The Great and the Conqueror was scheduled for an overnight visit at a disclosed location at Straven Road, flat number 2. Our mission was simple, as we chose to accept. How many lollies could we consume and how much mayhem could we create within 24 hours? So it began with a side hustle of acquiring money to fund our activities. This required the permission of Rose to first pick her flowers and put them into bunches. From there, we headed to the next door neighbours and proceeded to sell the flowers, with the punchline being, "Hi there, we are selling flowers to fundraise and create awareness for a foundation of your choice." To which a little old lady with a cheeky, knowingly smile on her face said, "That's awesome, I will choose the Cancer Foundation." Whilst we were young, our moral compass was tested, just to let all of you know that. Nevertheless, we marched on and showed Rose our takings. As we showed Rose, she took a moment and simply said, "I am not raising and taking care of too many Bryans, so I suggest you both go back and return that money." The night wasn't off to a good start, however, in classic Rosie style, she would then go on to say it was a mistake that could be turned into a learning curve and an experience. The night did improve, well, it probably couldn't have gotten any worse, so Rose thought. Our adventures continued around the yard into the shops and back, where we overindulged into the finer things in life, sweets, Shortland streets, and the infamous microwave bacon sandwiches. Now, just as a side note, as I became older, it was pointed out to me cooking bacon sandwiches in the microwave wasn't normal. Rose, I have a lot of things to thank you for in my life, but stitching me up like that was not one of them. Nevertheless, as the night went on, the Great and the Conqueror were becoming restless, so they decided to up the ante. This saw numerous forts being put up around the house, leaving Rose with no chance but to forfeit and go to bed. We topped off her night with an assorted range of vegetables being gently placed in her bed, which undoubtedly would have left an incredible mess and one pissed off Nana. Waking up in the morning, the Great and the Conqueror looked at each other and just knew what an awesome night it was. We got picked up later in the morning and a distinctive sentence was blurted to the parent at the time. I'm never looking after those two shitheads together ever again. And the rest was history. I've had so many delightful memories over the years with my partner in crime, Vincent, and we're going to miss you very much, Nan. Love you, Vinny. Over the years, myself, I've had so many fortunate and wonderful memories with you, Rose. You were a subconscious teacher of educator learnings in life, where lessons were taught from experiences. From our $10 adventures to the knick-knack market, where we would get 100 pieces of useless items that would never get used, I was able to understand and appreciate the value of money and making it last. To our games of bowls, bingo and canasta with your great friend Connie, who you can now be with. Our adventures continued to Cape Leeanga and back, where you were stuck with me counting all the way, and it wasn't until 2 weeks ago where you admitted to me how bored you were. You had a savage streak of truth that would put anyone in their place. We would then venture to the Avonhead Tavern for a cheeky sav, followed by a tot of Kahlua and $20 into the pokies, walking away doubling our money, feeling like we just won the lotto. That must have been the risk-taking part of life you were subconsciously teaching me. You were such a shining light in a dark room with a smile like no other. In your later years, you became a social media guru, and you were certainly winning at that. That does remind me though, at her request, I was meant to change her status when she passed to drinking wine with old friends and her occupation to haunting everyone in this room. You had an ethos of no judgment but acceptance for each individual, as your heart was so full of love and care. Towards the end, in your final days, you showed us all how tough you were, much tougher than we could ever be. There was nothing to you, but as Mark Twain once said, it's not about the size of the dog in the fight, it's about the size of the fight in the dog. I will never forget when you mustered the strength and looked both me and Shane in our eyes and said how much you loved us. Our hearts were broken, but our minds will never forget. In your final moments, I sat there and held your hand. I couldn't help but notice a plaque above you that said, "Grow old along with me, the very best is yet to be." And I guess that's a reminder to all of us that life is precious. But it's about enjoying and living each moment to the fullest and not taking ourselves too seriously. Rose, you exemplified this with your lively outfits, purple hair, and charismatic outlook on life. As the end was near, I thought to myself, what a hole is being left in our lives. But as you would want, it is up to our whānau to come together as one, to mend and be there for each other like never before, and to grow with united strength as we walk into the future. We love you, Nan. So, this is the end of one chapter, where the dancing queen is at her last dance, where the Sauvignon Blanc and Holidays Blue get passed along, and where the caterpillar cards flourish into butterflies towards greener and brighter pastures. Rose, you will forever be in our hearts, minds and souls. We're going to miss you so very much. May your body be at peace, may your spirit be alive, and may your legacy live on. That is a promise we as a family will keep. Ah, manaaki tanga. Ka ki te ano. Tino aroa mātou ki a koe. Tēnā koutou. Tēnā koutou. Tēnā koutou katoa. What? Don't do the fuck.
fucking my work, you painter!
Painter!
I will
fight you!
The white part of the
Monica, Monica!
The who got to keep
Monica, Monica!
Then let the who get gone, gone, and keep my love and cheap and cheap in my Monica, Monica! Then who got gone, who got the who? Then who go apple, apple, hair, go on, watch out!
Thanks, Jack. Outstanding. Now it's time for us to say goodbye. As siblings, all you could have done is made Rosie proud, and believe me, conversations I had with her over the years, as many did in this room, that's exactly what you've done. People will always forget what you said, and they'll always forget what you did. But they'll never forget the way you made them feel. And that lady made everyone feel special. Hence the reason that it hurts so much to say goodbye. Family look forward to having a chat with you about some of those great times once Rosie heads out to the hearse on her way to be cremated. I'm sure she would be absolutely proud of the send-off that all of you have given her today. It's been my pleasure to be part of it.
Thank you.
Rosie would say, go inside, have something to eat, have a cup of tea, and have a wine. Okay, so don't stand in the rain. Bar's open. There'll be food out any second. It's not out already. But you're more than welcome to come and touch the coffin or save it.
Rosie. planet.
See you, my darling. See you later. Not for a while.
Hello.